The Supreme Court has finally done it. 5-4, 5-4, 5-4. It isn't exactly overwhelming, but five justices have decided that the Congress isn't going to be able to define the benefits that come about from homosexual marriage. And the battle over same-sex marriage is far from over, despite the Supreme Court's ruling in two cases.
Leaders on both sides say the issue is still up to the states for now. And some Christian leaders say believers could become a target in future lawsuits over marriage. Paul Strand has the story from Washington.
Gay individuals and groups, as well as their lawyers who fought against DOMA and Proposition 8, now say the next step is to battle nationwide for legalized same-sex marriage everywhere.
We cannot forget our LGBT brothers and sisters that are in states that still discriminate against them, and we will not allow it.
Within 5 years, we will bring marriage equality to all 50 states in this vast country.
With marriage equality back in California, 40% of the population of the United States is covered by marriage equality.
The lawyers battling Proposition 8 say it's effectively dead because the justices ruled those defending it had no standing to defend it.
They said the proponents have no concrete injury. They cannot point to anything that harms them because these two loving couples and couples like them throughout California are now going to be able to get married.
Those on the other side weren't necessarily admitting defeat on Prop 8. They say at most the High Court has thrown California and gay marriage into somewhat of a legal limbo.
We remain committed to the continued enforcement of Proposition 8 until there is a statewide order saying otherwise.
Even as it wiped DOMA out, the court specifically did not say states have to legalize gay marriage. But its two rulings are big boosts to the gay marriage momentum.
Supporters of traditional marriage certainly have a beef with what the Supreme Court has done here. They're saying, how can five justices decide these crucial questions about marriage when the voters and the legislators in 38 states have decided differently?
One of the biggest problems with gay marriage is that in most states where it's become legal, Christians who stand up too clearly for traditional marriage end up getting bashed, sometimes sued. Could that now happen nationwide with DOMA's defeat, especially with the way the justices denigrated opponents of gay marriage?
Now that the majority said that laws defining marriage between one man and one woman are not supported by any rational basis, that they are driven by either ignorance or hostility, I fear that we're going to see a flood of lawsuits where that'll be the lead for the plaintiffs right out at the gate.
Reverend Rob Shank says believers need to get ready.
The script has already been written. Christians are angry, mean, bigoted, narrow-minded, ugly people. That's the stereotype. I think we have to do what we can to defeat that stereotype.
All sides on this issue say what the court has done here is important, but it certainly does not decide the question of gay marriage for all of America. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from the Supreme Court.
Well, Jay Sekulow for the American Center for Law and Justice is with us now. Jay, let me ask you about Anthony Kennedy. Does he have some clerks who happen to be gays?
Oh, I have no idea. I think what Justice Kennedy did, if you look at a series of cases that he's been involved in, he has taken the view that sexual orientation is a special class. So this is consistent with his opinions. Of course, Justice Scalia sharply disagreed. And Pat, there's one thing that has to be established here. The court did not strike down DOMA. They struck down one provision of DOMA, which was the only provision challenged, which was the federal benefit provision, which says if there's a same-sex couple that gets married in a state that allows same-sex marriage, that they get federal benefits, not state benefits, nor does another state have to recognize that marriage. So in a sense, it was narrow, but you have two different worldviews clashing in that opinion between what Justice Scalia wrote, which was a concern about the separation of power and the role of the courts, and Justice Kennedy, who was more focused on the what he would call the status of the individuals that were involved here. So that was the impact of what's going on with Justice Kennedy's opinion. I don't know about the background of his clerks. I've had a lot of cases in front of Justice Kennedy, and frankly, most of the time he rules in our favor, a vast majority of the time. This time, he took the position that this was basically a special status. But what's interesting, Pat, is when you turn it over to Proposition 8, there the court punted and said there was no standing. And some advocates are saying that the court has established a legal standard allowing same-sex marriage across the country. I'm not sure it's allowing same-sex marriage in all of California. It sent it back and said the district court opinion is going to apply. Now, it may well be that the other district courts in California would take the same position, But this is not even a court of appeals decision anymore, and the court saved for another day the idea that there be a constitutional right to same-sex marriage.
Jay, going into California, I understand the district court judge there either was a advocate of homosexual activity, was a homosexual, had a wife, was some connection. Can you elucidate that, or do you know?
Well, there was a real controversy because the judge's sexual orientation became, you know, unfortunately part of the case. And there were some other rulings that were issued there that became questionable. In fact, Justice Alito, in a footnote, footnote 7 in that opinion, talks about how the court basically, the trial court, created a circus environment during the trial here. But a majority of the court in the Proposition 8 case, which included the Chief Justice of the United States, Chief Justice Roberts, and Justice Scalia, as well as liberal members of the court, said there was no standing to bring the challenge. The court is cautious on standing issues, which generally, frankly, is helpful for our side, especially in the Establishment Clause cases. Here they found there was no standing, and four justices said, and again, it was conservatives and liberals on that side too, said there should have been a hearing on the merits, but there was no decision on the merits as far as a constitutional right regarding the redefinition of marriage. Could that come at a later date? Sure, and that's going to depend on who's at the Supreme Court at the time, which means elections have consequences.
Well, the standing thing, the state of California, Jerry Brown and his crew did not want to defend Proposition 8, so they punted. So it was a private individual that went in, and the state said he didn't have standing. Is that the idea? The court said that?
Yeah, it was an organization of individuals, and they didn't have standing. And under the California law, it was a closed case, whether an individual or an organization can defend a proposition. Interestingly, in the Defense of Marriage Act, there was another legal issue there, which Justice Scalia touched on, and that was, remember, the Justice Department didn't defend it, even though it was an act of Congress. That raised the issue. So both of these cases had these technical issues, and in the big case, which was Proposition 8, the court took the technicality, not because it's insignificant, by the way. Standing is a big issue, and the Chief Justice wrote four justices concurred with him, that there was no standing there to challenge it. Therefore, the Ninth Circuit decision, which was much broader than the district court, was no longer valid, and it goes back to the district court.
Let me ask you about the whole idea of the court. We've got the Congress of the United States overwhelmingly passing the Defense of Marriage Act, signed into law, I might add, by President Clinton. You've got California, Prop 8, which is overwhelmingly passed by the entire population, the citizens of the state. And both of those actions by an overwhelming group of citizens were overturned by, in the case of the Supreme Court, 5-4, in the case of California, one sitting district judge. It doesn't make sense.
Yeah, and what's, you know, this is part of the dissent from Justice Scalia focused on that, the idea that the court would have this much power and this much sway. The irony of California is they passed Proposition 8, and then they elected Jerry Brown to be the governor, who then instructed the attorney general not to defend the proposition. So it's a bizarre twist of electoral fate, if you will. But you point out an important point here, Pat, and that is, look, I'm not going to disparage any of the justices or their staffs or their clerks. I think we've got to look at the fundamental issue, is that what is the reach of the courts and what's the role of the courts as a co-equal branch of government? And that's what really Justice Scalia was getting to in his dissent in the Prop 8 case. And you know, that's really the question here. What is the role of the court in these major decisions? They didn't do a Roe versus Wade. They didn't constitutionalize a right here. They are letting the states still be the incubators of this, and I think it's 38 states prohibit it.
But if Kennedy says in that case on DOMA, he says that it was motivated by animus, some kind of whatever animus, isn't that going to stigmatize?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, that's the thing that people are worried about. I mean, we received a lot of calls yesterday from pastors saying, well, do I have to engage in our church in performing same-sex marriages, which you don't? The First Amendment Free Exercise Clause was not touched by this. But there is that concern. But, I think we should not overreact to this decision. I think the reaction needs to be measured. And measured means, look, really, other than the federal benefits going, I'm not saying that's insignificant, it's the status quo as it was before. 38 states, I think, do not allow same-sex marriage, 12 do, and the District of Columbia. And I think you've got some of those states have constitutional amendments that prohibit it. So, again, this was not a constitutionalized right here. at the end of the day. So I think we got to realize what we're dealing with. And the fight continues on both sides of this. Neither side's going away, that I can assure you.
One last question. The ACLJ is representing a number of Tea Party and other groups who have been slowed or denied tax-exempt status by the IRS. How's that case going?
Well, Pat, two big developments, one about 15 minutes ago. Number one, we just filed an amended complaint adding, as we discussed when we were with you last, adding 41 plaintiffs, including groups that were not Tea Party groups, just conservative organizations, pro-life organizations, some just educational groups that got caught up in this dragnet with the IRS. The IRS has put forward a plan, what they call a rapid response plan, an expedited review, almost like you go through the 10-item or less line at the checkout counter at the grocery store. You can get through quickly, and we'll give you your exemption if you agree to certain things. By the way, what they ask you to agree to is not constitutionally based nor statutorily based, so that's a problem. And this morning, just 10 minutes ago, the taxpayer advocate, which is part of the IRS, is offering $1,000 per person, or per organization, that was denied or delayed in their status. As the opening salvo in trying to settle this. I think you're going to see an aggressive attempt by the government to try to settle it. I don't think it's going to settle right away. And, Pat, there's going to be a hearing today with the acting commissioner and there a vote tomorrow in Congress to call Lois Lerner, who took the Fifth Amendment, back to the House to testify. So it's going well, and the IRS is trying to spin out of it. They try to put forward that there were some progressive groups that were targeted. Those progressive groups in an AP report yesterday said, well, we weren't asked obtrusive questions. It just took a little longer than we thought. So again, the IRS, the more they say, the worse it seems to get for them. Well, and now they're offering $1,000 per organization to
ridiculous.
Settle the case.
Well, you found
of
some
course.
Of those organizations.
But that's how they think.
Yeah, they may have spent hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars, lost revenue, et cetera. That doesn't compensate.
Right. Some of these organizations had, you know, franking privileges was for postage that was $22,000 or $30,000 a month. So the $1,000 a month, I could tell them about their $1,000 offer right here on the 700 Club. Not accepted.
All right. You heard it, Jay. Keep it up. God bless you. Thank you.
We'll do it. All righty.
Well, it looks like the Texas legislature will get another chance to pass an important abortion bill. Lee Webb has more on that story from the CBN newsroom. Here's Lee.
That's right, Pat. Texas Governor Rick Perry has called another special legislative session to try and pass abortion restrictions in that state. Democrat Senator Wendy Davis, along with a loud and angry crowd of pro-abortion protesters, blocked Republican efforts to pass a bill Tuesday night. Political observers, though, believe Republicans will be successful when the next special session begins Monday. Their bill would ban abortions after 20 weeks of pregnancy and establish tighter controls on clinics as well as doctors. Opponents say the measures could close nearly all abortion clinics in the Lone Star State. President Obama is in Senegal today. It is the first stop on his week-long tour of Africa. The president is visiting three countries there, the trip aimed at overcoming disappointment in Africa that America's first black president did not give more attention to that continent during his first term. The president will also be visiting South Africa and Tanzania, and he's expected to be greeted warmly there. The trip is expected, though, to cost up to $100 million. Some congressional Republicans have questioned that expense at a time when the sequester has led to spending cuts in government agencies. Well, major changes are coming to a school vending machine near you. High-calorie sports drinks and candy bars will be removed from schools across the country as early as next year. The unhealthy snacks will be replaced with diet drinks, granola bars, and other healthier items. The changes part of the child nutrition law passed by Congress in 2010 in an effort to battle childhood obesity. School lunch menus will also change. Greasy foods will be replaced by items like low-fat hamburgers, fruit cups, and yogurt. The food industry is on board and has been working with Congress to implement these changes, Pat.
Thank you. Wendy, does that make you happy that in lunch rooms you wouldn't eat that junk food anyhow, would you?
I loved Pizza Day. Yeah, and that's greasy, and, you know, pepperoni pizza and greasy hamburgers, but you know, kids are just so overweight these days, and I guess anything that can be done to get the junk food out of the machines, you know.
I tell you, when I was in business, I guess, law school someplace, I lost a lot of weight. I mean, I worked hard, and I was down to really trim weight. I was working out, and I was down low. So later on, I got a job as an assistant pastor in a church. And they didn't have pizza night, but they had
potluck.
Well, it was not potluck. It was just like Wednesday night they feed you, and it's what did they have? They had slimy, overcooked roast beef, lots of gravy, overcooked potatoes, mashed potatoes, white bread rolls, and apple pie.
I know in the South they cook the life out of like. The vegetables, you know, and they're just kind of soggy, and they have
no life. You get through eating that stuff, and you're starved because none of it satisfies, so you want more to eat. And before long, my weight started to go up, and, you know, it's one of those things you've been fighting ever since, but it's just terrible. Yeah. And those kids, if they're hungry, they go get a snack, and they get a Twinkies pack, or they get something with cookies or candy, or a sugary Coke, and they're starved. They eat it again, and it.
Well, they're putting diet drinks in there, which I don't think are any better for them, but I guess.
Worse. You
know, yeah, I think so.
Fruit drinks, maybe, but not diet drinks.
Amen.
Okay. Well, we've settled that. Wendy's going to be the food commissioner. All right, what's next?
Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel says the Pentagon is working to extend benefits to the spouses of gay military members as soon as possible. That includes health care, housing, and other federal benefits. Spouses of gay military members could also be allowed to be buried in Arlington National Cemetery. The plan is scheduled to go into effect on October 1st. The Pentagon estimates there are 18,000 same-sex couples in the U.S. military. The only abortion clinic in North Dakota has filed a federal lawsuit. It's challenging a state law that bans abortions as early as 6 weeks into a pregnancy. That's when an unborn baby's heartbeat can first be detected. The lawsuit is also challenging another state law that forbids abortions because of a genetic defect, such as Down syndrome. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.